theme of our discussions today, broadly speaking, will be the tension between the civil institution of marriage and institutions of marriage based on a particular religion or ethnic custom. In South Africa, where I come from, since early times, official recognition was given to indigenous African law, and it was enforced by the courts of South Africa. But that was subject to the condition that those laws would not be in violation of the white perceptions of natural justice. And for that reason, African marriages were not recognized as marriages, and they were in fact called customary unions. But the entire system of African customary law is founded on marriage and the family. And so by taking the foundation from under the law which the courts were entitled to apply to Africans living according to their customs, so many anomalies originated that one does not even want to begin to tell you about those. In 1997, the South African government passed legislation to afford legality to African customary marriages, both future ones and the existing ones. The problem that we had in the past, why it was not recognized as a marriage, was because those marriages are polygamous or could potentially be polygamous. I was interested to know how our government would get past the equality provisions in the South African Constitution, because while having legalized the African marriages, they've not done the same with Muslim marriages or Hindu marriages, which are also not recognized and are still not recognized as legal marriages. And then I came across a PhD thesis written by a young Muslim scholar in the University of the Western Cape, in which she said that the Muslim community of South Africa wants to deal with the problem of marriage in a different way. They want to persuade the government of South Africa to recognize that as a civil marriage, within the civil marriage paradigm, so as to prohibit polygamy within that community. And these two examples, I think, highlight what Professor Michael Broyde will be discussing today from a totally different perspective, namely the advantages and disadvantages of having a customary marriage or having one under the civil law system. Michael Broyde is an associate professor of law in the School of Law of Emory University, and he's also the academic director of the Law and Religion Program in our law school. He did his undergraduate studies in Yeshivite College and was ordained as a rabbi by the Yeshiva Theological Seminary. He obtained a JD degree, his basic law degree, from NYU, and before joining the faculty of Emory Law School, he was adjunct assistant professor of law in the Brooklyn Law School and an assistant professor in the Department of Religion at Emory University. He has a wide range of practical experience, which includes a judicial clerkship and a variety of offices associated with his primary interest, which is that of Judaic studies. He has written several books, including Pursuit of Justice, A Jewish Perspective on Practicing Law. He edited a volume on human rights and Judaism, cultural, religious, and political perspective. And he wrote yet another book, Marriage, Divorce, and the Abandoned Wife in Jewish Law. He has a long list of law review and other academic articles, which covers a number of pages in his curriculum vitae, which I will not read to you this afternoon. So please welcome Professor Michael Broyde, and I now give him the microphone.
At the last lecture, I saw Professor Amitai as the only lecture without a tie, which was not something I was prepared to do, but I figured I would take my jacket off compromise with him that way. The issue that I want to address today is marital pluralism, what place for religious marriage law. And I guess I want to review a certain amount of history and then describe the current status of family law in the United States, and then talk about the influence religious marriage laws might have on the future, and perhaps even suggest a vast recasting of family law along the system that Professor von der Weiber suggested is occurring in South Africa, although with a profoundly American twist. Essentially, historically, until the modern era, family law was private in its very nature. The farther back you go, the less family law was even perceived to be part of the classical legal code of a secular society. Starting about 500 years ago, family law became the bailiwick of religious communities, so that even societies that had secular law in an intense, robust way, nonetheless delegated to the various religious communities marriage and divorce law. This created a model in which religious law was not either part of the public or the private legal system of most common law countries, or even most European countries. For example, in England, for many, many, many years, there was no divorce unless you were Jewish, in which case you were allowed to have a Jewish divorce. And this was a general manifestation of a societal sense that family law was different than every other legal regime, because fundamentally it should be delegated outside of public or private law and handed over instead to ecclesiastical authority. This was true not only for divorce, but this was true for marriage as well. So if you take, for example, the classical intestacy case in Remey's estate, it involved a person who had married their niece in violation of the law of Rhode Island, but Rhode Island's law contained at that time an assertion that you could marry your niece if you were a member of the Hebrew faith, since in the Jewish tradition, marrying one's niece was not a form of incest. And it was not unusual to find that this form of delegation of the sum and substance of family law away from the civil legal authorities into the ecclesiastical community. Although you might think that this sounded very diverse and robust in the sense that at any given location there might be more than one family law system functioning, that view, the view as they say from 10,000 feet, would misunderstand the variety available to any single person. Any single person in this model typically was a member of only one faith group. Religious diversity was not so robust. And your ability to move from one faith group to another to take advantages of different or a more liberal or more conservative marriage law was very, very, very small. So even though in any one location you might have a number of different religious legal traditions governing family law, at one time, to any given person, they were centrally stuck in their faith group, unless, of course, they were prepared for a dramatic shift of changing religion, in which case they were still stuck with only one choice of family law, which was the religious group they had moved to. So if you were to take a snapshot picture of most European countries in the year 1840, you would see many diverse family laws. You could not talk intelligently about divorce law or marriage law or even family law in Germany. You instead have to talk about the divorce law or marriage law or family law of particular faiths. This created a very different perception of how family law functioned. Essentially, in America, this model of family law never took firm hold. Although there were common law marriages that were at their core ecclesiastical, it was always understood that these were delegations from the state. And essentially in the United States, other than perhaps a very brief experiment with southern states, Georgia being one of them with common law divorce, by 1810, there was no divorce anywhere in the United States other than by judicial enactment, and family law was well on its way to being state-run and state-supervised, such that certainly by the present time, family law is perceived to be a classical paradigm of state law. Contracts to marry require a license. Contracts to divorce require permission from the judiciary, and a classical model of an illegal contract is a private agreement of divorce. Marriage and divorce law have become centrally products of the state. Like hunting in the state of Georgia, marriage too requires a license, and although we could digress and talk about which is more dangerous, a hunting license or a marriage license, in the state of Georgia, it is easier to get a marriage license than a hunting license, although divorce is markedly more complicated. American family law is not so simple, though, because even though family law is controlled by the state, the full faith and credit clause of the United States Constitution essentially requires that every state recognize the validity of every marriage and, more interestingly, every divorce performed in every state of the Union. Until about 1940, all of this was abstract theory because, to invoke a term that everybody dislikes intensely, the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure limited jurisdiction to those states that you either resided in as a married couple or got married in. But starting around 1940, the Supreme Court gave a much more robust interpretation of jurisdiction, and it allowed for states to become divorce mills such that one party in a marriage could leave their home, move to that state, and get a unilateral no-fault divorce if that state permitted it. This was a revolution that seems very subtle, but was really very profound to American divorce law because it gave rise to divorce mills, states that had liberal divorce laws that everybody and anybody who wanted to get divorced could run to. All of this seems very much secondary to our topic of marital pluralism, but in fact it's extremely related. Marital pluralism in the United States at its core revolves around the fact that even though states may enact marriage and divorce laws that seem unique to their state, in fact, in our current construct of the laws, these laws are ineffective. And the reason why they are ineffective is if you don't like the divorce law in your state, you can pack up and fly to Nevada for 3 weeks and get a Nevada divorce that is recognized in every state of the Union. And this creates very intense pressure on family law in a race to the bottom, because you can't have your state's family law dramatically different from the law in any other state, because people will simply cross boundaries for short periods of time and run to divorce mills, for the absence of a better word. So when you talk about marital pluralism in the United States, what you really have to realize is American law has created a construct in which it's very hard to put forward robust alternative models of marriage in a way that seems actually successfully binding. So even though you'll have heard a lot about Louisiana's covenant marriage law, right now in the construct of American law, this diverse model of marriage is ineffective, because even if you get a covenant marriage in Louisiana, if you don't want to be covenantal, not if both of you don't want to be covenantal, but if one of you doesn't want to be covenantal at some point in your marriage, you just hop on a plane to Nevada and get yourself a Nevada divorce, and there's nothing Louisiana or the covenantal marriage that you agreed to can do to stop that. The theme of today's presentation by me is an attempt to present a model for what a different form of family law might look like in American society, and to focus on how to build a diverse, pluralistic family law system. At its core, family law is more contentious than many other legal systems, precisely because what we have at stake are family values. Family law is a way that our society thinks about very intense marital values. Contract law, or tort law, and certainly civil procedure, don't cause people to get as socially or culturally aggravated as family law does. As we saw here, discussions about same-sex marriage cause otherwise docile individuals to get aggravated in ways that we simply don't get worked up over the Uniform Commercial Code or many other aspects of law. It just doesn't seem worth fighting over. But yet, when you talk about family law, people seem genuinely concerned about entry into a society where there's either fault or no fault, where polygamy is overtly discussed, or any other such conversations. Family law is a process by which our most intimate arrangements are formed, and people take a great deal of interest in it. It is at its core a value-laden discipline. Because it's a value-laden discipline, it causes people to want their values reflected in the law. It leads to cultural wars that are very robustly about what we want to look like and how we want to function. This has caused family law to be a source of contention that most other areas of law simply don't care about. Most other people don't care about the form and content of family law. But you see ready congressional action when a state considers same-sex marriage that you wouldn't see if the state considered the reversal of the famous mailbox rule of contracts. One would be hard-pressed to imagine congressional interference at all in these matters. It turns out that family law is about who we are. And who we are bothers us very intensely. And we recognize that the law as it is formed very much affects the stability of each and every one of our family relationships. After all, no-fault divorce is really a conversation about how each and every one of our marriages can end. So when you have conversations about robust state family law, you readily begin to realize that people really do get worked up. And it turns out that the problem in America is a profound and severe one. The problem is that there are a number of different visions of marriage that appear in the United States. These provisions of marriage, at their core, are radically different. Are radically different one from another. The conceptualizations of marriage found in the gay and lesbian community differ dramatically from that found in the Catholic community, which look yet very different from the Mormon polygamous community, which looks yet very different from the secular liberal community in the United States. And these conceptions of marriage are practical and community forming. What has happened thus in the United States is, since family law is an area where everybody can run to a state to seek their own family law, very robust, dynamic fights about family law are occurring in the United States. The recent ALI proposal to dramatically recast family law and essentially diminish the status of marriage is understood by the morally conservative community to be an attack on the institution of marriage. And they're right. That doesn't mean their criticism is right, but their understanding of the stakes is 100% correct. How to fix this problem is a very fascinating problem. There are, broadly speaking, two theoretical solutions to the problem of robust family law in the United States. The current solution is, it's a winner-take-all battle. Various political organizations fight to form family law, and the stronger of the two puts forward a model of family law which it crams down the throat of the other group. For many years, in the beginning of the 20th century, the dominant group was hard-fought divorce, and that was the tone and texture of most of the family law. In the last 30 years, the dominant tone and texture has been unilateral no-fault divorce and easy exit for marriage. Those people who didn't want that couldn't get it. You had to get married, essentially, in a unilateral no-fault state, and there was nothing you could do that would prevent your spouse at some point in the future from getting out of the marriage that you had entered into through the exercise of their unilateral no-fault divorce rights. You couldn't contract against it, and you couldn't say this wasn't the deal we had at the time that we got married. Essentially, marriage law came in only one size and one shape, and what that one size and one shape was a political response crafted depending on the politics of any given time and place. The alternative model, which perhaps is medieval, is what I wish to present to you here. I wish to contemplate with you here a very different model of family law. It's the marital pluralism model, in which states put forward not one model of marriage, but many, and individuals choose their model of marriage. And by the way, not only their model of marriage, of course, you understand, but your model of divorce at the time that you get married. And this model sticks with you throughout your marital union and governs your relationship at the time of divorce. It envisions not just one model or two models, but a number of different models. The hallmark, however, of these models is once you enter into them, you're stuck in them, and you must get divorced by these models as well. Because if you think about it, the real test of family law isn't the criteria for getting married. Marriage is always, I find, very easy. People who get married to each other tend to be friends. They think they're compatible one with another. To the extent that they fight in the course of getting married, the fights tend to be small rather than large. If they're big fights, what happens? They don't get married. But once they start having large fights in the course of their marriage, that creates a very different dynamic. Marriage law is really at its core measured by when it permits exit from your marriage and under what circumstances. In a pluralistic model of marriage, the state will put forward a half a dozen different models of entry and exit into marriage. And by putting forward these models, people, meaning men and women, who are coming to get married, will have to reach an agreement not only that they want to get married, but that they want to get married in a particular model. And this model will affect not only how they get married, but when and with what access to divorce they have. To use this as a thought exercise, I want to construct for you a model of a Catholic marriage, which is if you agree to get married in a Catholic ceremony without any other model of marriage present, you understand that you have no access at all to divorce, and that in order to get remarried, you would need a church-granted annulment. Now, the question becomes, not that the state should compel this model on everybody, but imagine what the world would look like if we had a Catholic model of marriage that people could enter into. The question is, who would enter into this model? And how would it impact on the structure of marriage if you chose this model? Now, I envision in this diverse pluralistic model that the state would put forward many different shades of marriage, one of which I could well imagine would be a same-sex marriage, one of which I could well imagine would be easy exit from marriage, one of which I could imagine is polygamous. We miss the fact that there are thousands and thousands of people in polygamous marriages who are without any legal recognition, essentially, of their marital relationship. What happens is law will put forward not a single model, but models that you have to choose from that affect and regulate your choices upon exit. This construct begins to resemble private family law from 500 years ago. It will look like Europe did when family law was given to religious communities. However, there will be one significant difference, and this significant difference has within it the ability to reshape everything we see in family law. Multiple models will actually be available at one time and one place to the same person. This will go far, in my sense, to reduce the cultural wars that are running in family law, because it will turn out that you can have more than one model of marriage peacefully coexisting in any one society, and individuals will choose their own model for themselves. What will this look like? The answer is that it will turn us into some sort of a millet system of marriage, in which the state delegates marriage and divorce law to separate, even we can use the term, parochial groups on occasion. There undoubtedly would be a Catholic model of marriage. There would be a diverse, robust number of Jewish models, since Jewish unity is at its core an oxymoron on a theological level. And so too with many other faiths, and not only faiths, but many other substantive values and virtues that cause us to think about marriage. If you think about the state of New York has put forward a robust model of marriage in which adultery is not thought to be grounds for fault in the ending of a marriage. We are talking, when you say that, about a substantive value system about what marriage really ought to look like. Some people undoubtedly want that marriage. Some people undoubtedly don't. New York State, by putting forward only one model of marriage, forces this value on its diverse citizens, some of whom want it, some of whom don't. To think about how to build this kind of model of marriage requires a recognition that a number of different doctrines that we've encountered need to be recast. And I guess the thrust of this lecture on a technical level is how family law looks differently if you allow these recastings to actually occur. Three things centrally look different. The first is the recasting of marriage as contract. The only way you can justify marital pluralism and a religious model of marriage in our robust free exercise society is by putting forward religious models of marriage on a contractarian basis. Nobody's forced to enter into a religious model of marriage, but anybody and everybody can choose it. Marriage is thus become like ice cream in the ice cream shop. You order your own particular collection of flavors and your own toppings, and whatever you agree on and you order, that's what you have to pay for. It's very different than the historical status determinations that ran robustly throughout American law. Second thing is, and this is perhaps much harder, is the realization that some people will make bad choices, and people will agree on marital arrangements that it will turn out is bad for them, either because they're in love, or overwhelmed with lust, or simply bad bargainers, what we otherwise would call in a different context, stupid, making profound errors of judgment. It's important to understand that a byproduct of this type of contractarian system is the recognition that when people enter into bad contracts, these bad contracts have to generally be enforced. Of course, there become limits. There are doctrines such as unconscionability, and a marriage contract which says that one spouse may hit another becomes void, I guess, as violative of public policy. But broadly speaking, when you envision a pluralistic model of marriage, you recognize that people crafted their own marriages and was in a much wider range of agreements, these models of marriage are thought to be perfectly proper and acceptable to the general framework of society. Thirdly, technical doctrines, which are very important modern doctrines in procedure of divorce law, need to be changed. People no longer can run from one state to another to take advantage of liberal divorce law, since at their core, your divorce law will no longer be determined by the state that you're part of, but it will instead be determined by the arrangements you entered into in the course of your marriage. So when you step back and you think about this type of marital pluralism, it causes family law to look astonishingly different. It causes family law to almost look like first-year contracts. The most the law will do is it will establish a set of default laws, default rules for your contractual arrangements in marriage, but in the end, you'll be able to recast your marriage or cast your marriage in whatever way you see fit. This is such a foreign notion to us because we are deeply rooted in the following social cultural phenomena. Religious authority is something that we're free to ignore, and that even though we will go to an ecclesiastical figure, a rabbi, a priest, or a minister, to get married, we reserve the right, and we intuit it as correct, that when it comes time to get divorced, those religious promises that we made in the course of marriage fall by the wayside, and we are instead governed by secular divorce law. So normal American experience with family law causes us to look at a proposal for marital pluralism and think, my gosh, this is a recasting of the whole thing. And to some extent, it is. It's a proposal for an incredibly robust, very diverse recasting of all the family law. Why do I think this type of recasting is at its core a good idea? I guess I have three public policies that push me in this direction. The first is my observation that the very fabric of American society is being torn apart by the question of family values and diverse social, sexual, family experiences. We perceive at least two models out there, one of which we call the religious historical, one of which we call the modern secular. And the simple fact is that I don't think these two models can be bridged, and I don't think a single legal system can successfully regulate both models. Since I don't think a single legal system can successfully regulate both of these models, I think a legal system that attempts to regulate both with one law is doomed to create profound social tension, creating at least two and maybe many more models of marriage, puts forward the possibility that law will satisfy many more customers, and people will be able to find the model of marriage, and by the way, the model of divorce, that interests them. And that's a very important value, that law should put forward family law that reflects, in fact, the practice of the people that are out there. The second thing is, and since this is a conference that discusses religious values, is the recognition that the marginalization of religious values in marriage is itself problematic in the American tradition. Although the state will delegate marriage to ecclesiastical figures, it's a delegation of the trivial, because marriage is easy. Until law is prepared to substantially delegate divorce, which is where marriage law becomes interesting, complex, adversarial, and value-laden, religion will never have a serious role in family, and family is at its core a place where religious values are manifest. You shouldn't think, by the way, that this will be empowering of all religions. I have a sense, maybe just to reflect my own biases, that if we were to say that if you're married in a Catholic mass, you cannot have access to the divorce law in the United States, period, This would decrease, rather than increase, the number of people married in a Catholic ceremony. It might be so that this is true in the Orthodox Jewish tradition as well. If we gave teeth and said, if you were married by an Orthodox rabbi, you can't remarry until you receive a Jewish divorce, it might cause people to opt out of the Jewish marriage system as well. But the notion that people will take religion seriously in the area of family law, even seriously in that they contemplate walking away and saying, this is wrong and I don't want to be part of it, that's a very valuable thing for the American society. Taking religion seriously, even by walking away from it, is a manifestation of the importance of religion. What's happened instead in family law is clergy is something you go to for a party, but substantive issues don't get handled by the same clergy who were there for your marriage. So I turn to you and say the second substantive value is it will be empowering of the religious communities for those who wish, by their own choice, to go get a religious marriage. The third value, and perhaps the most substantive value that's out there, is it allows society to create diverse models. And these diverse models force people to confront issues within their marriage before they get married and make sure that they have substantive agreement on what their marriage is supposed to look like. Studies have shown that in Louisiana, with its two levels of marriage, covenantal and non-covenantal, people walk into the marriage office to get married, and they can't agree on whether they want a covenantal or a non-covenantal marriage. And you know what happens? They don't get married, because part of the issue that fosters a high divorce rate is easy entry to marriage. Just like giving out hunting licenses without providing adequate lessons leads to hunting accidents, giving marriage licenses out without adequate lessons produces marriage accidents. And as uncomfortable as we are with this, turning to people and saying, here are a robust number of models of marriage. Before you can get married, you have to agree on a model. And if the boy looks up and says, I want unilateral, no fault divorce, with adultery not being a problem, and the girl says, I want hard fault divorce, with adultery producing enormous financial penalties, they will have that conversation before they get married. And they might not get married. On the other hand, if we allow them to simply skip daintily down to the marriage license bureau, where only one type of marriage is available, they'll just take the one license out that's available to them, and their marital problems won't come home to roost until they're already married, and there's much larger social damage associated with the early ending of the marriage. And I think, by the way, that this will as well reduce the tension over same-sex marriages. I think precisely because we have only one family law system, the fight over same-sex marriage is robust and hard, because what's at stake is the marriage system. If we instead recognize that there can be diverse models of commitment and marriage, the notion that secular society can build a model of marriage grounded in same-sex marriages isn't bothersome to a diverse number of people, not because they will necessarily approve, but the process of putting forward five or six different models of marriage will as well cause people to recognize that there are many models of marriage that they don't like, and because there are many models of marriage that they don't like, they'll be comfortable with this model also being one that they don't like. So I have a sense that what ails American marriage law is a narrowness of options available to it, both at entry and at exit. And the solution to that model is not to switch to a different single model. It's not that we should return to New Hampshire's divorce law in 1901, which limited divorce to cases of hard fault, and if only we go from liberal marriages to conservative marriages, everything will be fine. It's a very different solution. It's the recognition that different people require different marriages, and different communities look for different structures in their marriage, and law ought to put forward a variety of different robust models. If I had to guess, I would guess that the implementation of this model, of these models, will produce not only lawful polygamy, but lawful same-sex marriage. It will as well produce marriages with no access to divorce, and it will as well produce marriages with access only to divorce in cases of hard fault. The recognition of the fact that there is no single right answer to this question, but instead there is simply a set of models out there that society should conform to broadly, will create a very different model of society. I don't know if this will happen. The alternative I can well envision. The alternative will be countless decades of profound fighting between the liberal and conservative community about whether the single marriage law should be liberal or conservative. For many years it was conservative, for the last 30 years it's been liberal, and the tide perhaps is changing again, and the battle will be entered into again by both sides. Instead of encouraging this battle by insisting on a single model, now might be the time to rethink the whole and put forward instead a robust model of pluralistic marriages, which has a place for religion, it has a place for non-religion, it has a place for varieties of expressions of the family unit. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much to Michael. There's now time for comments and questions. You first.
I can just imagine the public discussion about debates about who gets to call their marriage what, real marriage versus, But my question would be, if you describe this as being kind of a contractarian state with more than a model of a variety of marriages, would the couple, the married couple, upon mutual consent be able to shift the type of marriage that they are in?
So I think in contractarian principles, parties can revise the contract midstream through mutual consent with proper assurance of free will participation. One always has to worry that changes of this type don't have enough procedural protection. But I could well imagine a couple going through a religious epiphany and moving their model of marriage from one faith to another, or a complete loss of faith and a movement of the model from a religious community to a secular community, or the other way around. So the answer is, in my view, contractarian models allow the recasting of the contract midstream with the consent of all the parties. The unstated problem, of course, is the question of the children in that model, but presumably parents as guardians are allowed to make religious faith decisions about their children, even if that entails a dramatic movement of one type or another. So I don't think the church would have to recast its sacrament, but I think the church would have to recognize, as it does now, that even though you can get a sacramental marriage, you can get a civil divorce. All that this would require is that if you got a sacramental marriage to get a civil divorce, both parties would have to consent. This would only be, from the Catholic Church's perspective, an improvement over the current state of affairs in which both parties can come for a Catholic marriage, but either party can run to Nevada for 3 weeks for a civil divorce. So I don't think the lot of the church would be hurt at all by this model. I think it would only be improved. I would have a hard time, consistent with my notion of free exercise of religion, to require a faith grounded decisions to be unchangeable even with the consent of all the parties. So I could see one saying, once entered into a Catholic marriage or a Jewish marriage or a Muslim marriage, can't be exited from at all. But I would have a hard time putting that forward in a free exercise model, just like I recognize as a matter of American law, you can leave the Catholic Church or the Jewish synagogue, and even though Judaism doesn't recognize any exit out, and neither does Catholicism, you can't compel people to come worship with you consistent with their free exercise rights. So I confess to you that I've never found the benefits problem to be a central debate. I think the benefits problem is almost a technical point. It's easy to recast health insurance to cover polygamous marriages. The Marriott Corporation does it already without any complex difficulty. This is not a technical problem. This is not us great minds who have figured out how to run the world's most sophisticated commercial code can't figure out how to deal with polygamous marriages. Meaning this is not a technical problem, this is a values problem. When the government decides that it wishes to extend benefits to polygamous or polyandrous or other forms of marriage, it will assign the problem to great legal minds who will craft the solution. So I think the government benefits access is only a problem to the people who fundamentally disagree with the principle. It's not a technical legal problem. Jewish law, which I'm intimately familiar with, has no active polygamy around, but it has a well-established, thoughtful legal code for how to deal with benefits of marriage in the context of polygamy. I've thought more than once about giving a law school class on how to run family law in a polygamous situation. It's not hard as a matter of technical Jewish law, although, as I've said many times in other contexts, the Hebrew word for co-wife is a synonym for the word trouble. So family law certainly looks different in a polygamous situation, but it's not technically hard. So I don't think addressing the benefits problem goes to the core of the issue. The benefits issues can be addressed if we decide we want to extend benefits to all of these different models of marriage. So I guess there are two different questions. One question is the people who read the fine print but are naive enough to believe that the fine print will never apply to them. And the second is the people who genuinely don't read the fine print. I think the answer to the first group is tough. Meaning, at some level, the nature of contractarian models are people will learn over time that if you read an agreement and you understand the agreement, and you just don't contemplate that some parts of the agreement will apply to you in the end, we have no choice but to apply our contractarian rules and say, learn to read before you sign. The second group, I think, is a little bit more problematic, but society can and should enact rules that protect people who are not capable of genuinely evaluating their choices. But these are not substantive restrictions. These are procedural restrictions. It might be that to enter into one marriage or another requires a waiting period or, you know, a certain point size on the form. I don't have exact answers for how to deal with the problem of people who leap and then look. But this is not a problem uniquely limited to marriage law. This is as much about people who choose law as a career after watching L.A. Law many times, or any other bad choices that people make that don't seem, that seem with hindsight not so correct. Lots of contracts can't be gotten out of. You can't. Your position isn't that all contracts are voidable just because you leaked and then looked. Some contract law creates problems, and the problems are not solvable.
Michael, great to hear this vision that I've heard bits and pieces of over the last year, still all the way out. You're very close in your position to the position that Martha Feinman is suggesting. But she has a vision of individualizing contracts far beyond, I think, your vision, because you talk about a kind of a finite number, as if there could be a finite number of models. But I can imagine once you find 5, 6, 10, the people would come up and say, you know, there's still not one that fits me. So what would restrict your model from becoming highly individualized and simply something that any 2 or 3 people would compose as they fit and hope that the government somehow or other, the court, would enforce them if need be? How do you restrict that?
So I think where I differ from Professor Feinman and Bernstein is in one very significant way. They want the government to essentially ignore your status, and they favor the abolition of marriage as a legal category. And I have no problem with even more individualized models than 5 or 6, but I favor the government recognizing marriage as a status and continuing to privilege it in many different ways as it still privileges marriage. So where I disagree with Professors Feinman and Bernstein isn't over the number of varieties, it's over the government response. I still think that marriage should be privileged, and government should provide benefits related to marital status. Government should not close its eyes to marital status. Instead, government should allow a more robust definition of marital status. It's not whether there are 5 marriage models or 17 marriage models. It's whether the Internal Revenue Code should require on your tax returns that you mention whether you're married or single. Those who favor the abolition of marriage favor government's complete removal from the marriage system. I simply favor an expanded government measure of marriage, but I'm still perfectly comfortable with either a marriage penalty if the government in its wisdom wants to penalize marriage, or a marriage bonus if the government in its infinite wisdom wants to give a bonus to marriage, or health care benefits relating to marital status, whatever the case might be.
Would you ever envision a third tier? You have singly that marriage. Maybe you develop a floor below which you don't define this relationship as marriage anymore. There's certain constants that marriage would entail. And you have another category which would be more like a simple contract, which 2 people could enter into. Is that a very contrary term? We call it marriage because it doesn't meet certain tests, but that it's still binding those parties. And it's either civil kind of an arrangement that would be binding within.
I don't doubt for a minute, by the way, that the Internal Revenue Service and the tax court would, under my model, develop measures for bona fideness in marriage. Because at some level, when you have robust models, the government has no choice but to develop a test to determine if you're genuine. But I would favor a healthy, robust test rather than a narrow, parochial one. Its exact contours are not for the here and now. But in my view, one would have to develop a sorting mechanism to distinguish bogus from real. I certainly acknowledge that because this system is open to the possibility of bogusness. But yet, we recognize that this test for realness in a marriage wouldn't necessarily have to be so narrow and conventional. There is a literature on how the Marriott Corporation determines who should be able to enter into a polygamous healthcare contract and not let people sell access to their health care because one of them is a Marriott employee. So it's a complicated conversation, but I remain convinced that it's doable.
Is this available in any of the countries in the Near East that have large faith communities of quite different views?
The answer is the millage system is common in many countries, but it's not at all structured in this way, because typically the typical faith adherent has access to only one community. So in India, you can get married in more than one model, but in the real world, in fact, a Muslim is stuck in a Muslim marriage, and a Hindu is stuck in Hindu marriage, because you could, in theory, apostatize from one faith to the other for the sake of getting married, but there are enormous social consequences to that apostasy, such that you are unlikely to engage in that activity merely for the temporary benefit of marriage law. South Africa, as Johan said, is a more diverse, robust model, but I have a suspicion that people don't, in fact, go to tribal marriages to be polygamous unless they're a member of the tribe, and that it would be hard for Johan or I to decide you wanted to take a second wife and join a South African tribe to do this. I'll bet that there's a legal mechanism to prevent me from doing this. That,
to the best of my knowledge, it just doesn't happen.
I don't know. What do you think would be the response if somebody tried to do this?
I think the problem would be that what is protected in South Africa is the customary system, and you have to be part of the customary community in order to uphold the laws and the traditions of the group.
So I think that this is thus unlikely. There are no paradigms for this out there, even as there are still systems of diverse family law. Typically, any given one person or any given one couple only has access, in fact, to one legal system. I'm proposing that people be given substantive access to a number of different models of marriage, each of which is open to them. Unlike a system like in Turkey, where there are six or seven different models of marriage, but you are either a Jew or a Turk or a Kurd, and you, in fact, have access to only one model, even though if you were a lawyer, you would see robust models. I'm proposing that people who get married themselves have to go to the marriage license store, and there are different marriage licenses of different types, and you have to pick one, and both of you have to sign it. I think that there are two ways people can reject models. We can put forward a model, but no man or no woman will voluntarily enter into such a model if we put the right barriers of consent in front of them. But in my broad view of marriage, models that attract a man and a woman who both agree to enter into these models and understand their provisions and consent to them, the state ought to allow a relatively robust set of these models, even if it turns out to be, it's a model that you or I might look down on. So,
I think you're being optimistic about the state saying certain models would be okay.
Well, because of the full faith and credit clause, I have this sense that between the 50 states, if we go to a diverse model of marriage, many states will put forward some models, and many states will put forward other models, and many different robust models will exist. And moving from one state to another for the marriage ceremony itself will prove relatively easy. This assumes that states will be forced to recognize marriages of their co-states, which is a technical Supreme Court proposition, but one that I wager is correct. One that I wager is correct.
How can marital pluralism
Well, I think not only is that true, I think which one is superior to which one will be very much determined by locale. I don't know that the model of marriage that's thought to be superior in Valdosta is necessarily the same model that will be thought to be superior in Napa Valley. I think there'll be a lot of regional variety. And that regional variety has certain advantages, and it reflects the diversity of American experiences. Undoubtedly, some locations will develop strong traditions favoring one model of marriage or another. But I think it's unlikely that the same model that dominates the urban cities in the Northeast will be the same model that dominates the rural South, which will be the same model as the Pacific Coast. So I don't know. I suspect there's much more variety than you're giving credit to. And if it turns out the consensus of the country goes with one model of marriage, that too would be something worth witnessing. I'll put it in a more broad sense. The answer is yes, but putting it more broadly requires a recasting of vast rules of jurisdiction in family law, because what you can't prevent, what you have to prevent, is you have to prevent a single state from having easier rules of marriage and allowing people to visit that state and adopt those rules. So it's not just the Defense of Marriage Act that would have to go. But more generally, the notion that you can go to Nevada for 3 weeks and get a unilateral Nevada divorce would have to go. The Supreme Court decisions from the 40s and 50s allowing jurisdiction in marriage to vest in any state in which one of the two married parties is in would have to go out absolutely completely. But who wants to burden a conference like this with the details of the procedural modifications necessary? We're trying to paint with a big picture, and the words big picture and jurisdiction just never go hand in hand, as those of you who are in law school know.
I wonder if there would be an increase in discrimination claims if there were the broad category of marriages that were acceptable. I guess in looking at, for example, if Vermont recognizes a third type of union and it's not recognized in any other state, I think you'd foresee that there would be similar problems where states that have a sort of quite more conservative ethic where a certain area does, that they would not recognize marriage C on the list.
So I think the founding fathers got it right in the full faith and credit clause, which is, I think it's essentially, one is hard-pressed to imagine the union surviving in the area of family law if one state has a model of marriage that another state labels sexual relations consistent with that model to be a felony. So I don't think that the Defense of Marriage Act is consistent with the spirit of the Constitution, speaking with a very broad brush, but more specifically, I don't think it's consistent with a robust model of marriage. If we're going to put forward diverse, pluralistic models of marriage, the ground rules have to be that if you're married in one state, in one model, that one state and one model is jurisdictionally binding on every state in the union, just like if you're divorced in one state and one model, that's jurisdictionally binding on every state in the union.
It seems to me that one of the major problems of modern family law is the ability of courts
I don't know. It's a hard question. It certainly would take the problem of morality out of the hands of family law judges and would, in essence, force the couple to negotiate the ground rules for morality in their marriage before they get married. I think that generates judicial efficiency. Meaning, contractarian models are ones the judges like, because judges loathe, I think, maybe I'm wrong, judges loathe to impose their own models and would much rather have the parties put forward a pre-existing model which the judges are bound to. Certainly, such a system promotes judicial efficiency of dispute resolution, because the central issue, if you don't have an agreement beforehand, is what was the agreement supposed to be? Once you force people to enter into diligently articulated models of marriage before they get married, divorce becomes much simpler because the ground rules for divorce are previously specified. Just like modern American family law very much favors prenuptial agreements, precisely because they make divorce so much smoother if you agree on how to get divorced after the fact. So those judges who enjoy cramming their own views down the throats of litigants, neither of whom want them, would find this disconcerting. But I don't think that's a common problem in the judiciary, I think. So I hope that that answers this kind of question. One last question and then we'll stop.
It seems like your model both celebrates and denigrates the individual at the same time, because it celebrates by letting individuals choose a variety of models that are happy with the individual versus the system of marriage and not this one. But it denigrates the individual because it doesn't allow one of those two partners to grow in the course of their lifetime. And so if one of the two partners in marriage grows and they does not grow in the same way, that partner who grows, unlike the UCC where they're bound by their contract and they have to pay $1,000 penalty, here they're saying because of their bad bargain for 27 years of their life, for example. And that, I think, is what we fundamentally unfair and satisfying to respond to that.
I confess to you that you're right. It denigrates the individual by compelling the individual to put a great deal of thought and care into what they want before they get married, and it compels them to live with that model. And it is a denigration of change, because change in a marriage itself is a form of fault if it's not done without the consent of the spouse. So yes, I think you are right, but I think you've trivialized the strength of contract, because the strength of contract isn't only that you pay $1,000. Sometimes the consequences of breach of contract are dire and systemic and life-altering. So I don't think that it would be unusual to find contracts that were well entered into outside the area of family law whose consequence of breach is dramatic and substantive. This would be yet another example.
As Chair, I claim the last word. While we were discussing the subject, I was just thinking about this very salient principle of international law, which is one of the most basic principles, referred to as the right to self-determination of people, and people being defined as national or ethnic, religious or linguistic groups. And this principle demands of states to respect the right to self-determination of such groups, which means the state must permit them to live according to the traditions and the customs of the group. And I think that what Michael was saying to us today is somewhat parallel to the principle of the right to self-determination, whereas the Feynman-Bernstein model is not. And this is just something that we might further explore to find international sanctions for this kind of pluralism. And having said that, please join me in thanking Michael for the most stimulating